I like always challenging myself. I mean, I don't want to say, look, all right, now I've done it all. I'm just coasting until whenever I decide to retire. The beauty of journalism and the beauty of the job I have is that it's always something different every day. So, and I continue to like to try different things. And the beauty of freelancing now is because I'm not under contractual obligations. When you work for a network directly, they are very controlling. Everything from what you write to what you, the interviews you do to even your persona, that is owned by them. So freelancing now, I can start to do stuff I didn't get to do. Movie trailers. Every now and then they need a reporter. I find that to be kind of interesting, you know. I'm not going to do anything too wacky, but if they say, we just want you to play the journalist that you always play, and if the script is not outrageous, then yeah, I'll consider doing that. It's a new experience. I get to see a movie making. You know, we all watch them, but what's it like to be a part of them? So this is where I've been able to kind of, you know, push the envelope a bit. And then, you know, the documentary I talked about, or a lot of documentaries. I enjoy documentary work. So I find all of that as growth as a human being and as a journalist. As far as, you know, the sharing the world, but first of all, you know, we have to realize, of course, we've gone through what was called the American century. You know, now we're into a new century. You know, there's some debate as to whether it's going to be the Chinese century or whether it's going to be the Indian century or what kind of century it's going to be. But it's clear that other nations are rising up. And this is the goal, of course, of democracy. This is the goal of what we've always espoused as a nation. We don't pretend or hope that the United States is a monopoly. We would enjoy that others, one, adopt the form of government we have because we tend to believe it is the finest and most democratic. But we would like to see economies rise. We'd like to see people, their lives improve. And that's what we are seeing. I mean, with China and with India and with other third world nations that are really beginning to improve. But then, of course, it means that there is going to be friction because we also see this as a challenge to the United States. How we deal with this is going to decide where the world will be in the next 100 years. So a realization that we have led for a long time. Sometimes the greatest leadership is that you coax instead of say, follow me, follow like we had done. And so when I say we need to share the world, it's just this realization that we're all in it together here. And we can either fight one another over it and tear each other apart about it, or we can realize that there are a lot of good things we could share. So that's what I'm saying. And that's the beauty of conversation. I mean, you realize you can go and talk to people who are strangers, and you can talk to somebody who you think you're not going to like. But I guarantee you, the moment you sit down face-to-face with them, you begin conversing, the attitudes change. The hatred begins to melt away. The eyes open, as does the mind, with the realization that, wow, you know what? I think that too. You know, there things begin to melt and bonds begin to be formed. And that's the beauty of our industry. You know, we can communicate. We can talk. We've gone from broadcasting to where it's all just one way. You know, now with all the ability of means of, we can bring the conversation back to me. And that's a wonderful experience to get this feedback and talk. We can converse. And that's a new era for us in this industry. I think it'd be naive to think that it didn't have some sort of impact. I mean, growing up with, you know, traveling back and forth to Europe, being exposed at a young age to different countries and realize it's not all just America. And again, I stress, I'm an American citizen and proud of it. But I am a citizen of the world, so to speak, too. So I think, yeah, it's greatly influenced me. But I think also, you know, for all of you, you're growing up at a different time, in a different world. And we all know that our world, meaning the old folks, it changed, 9/11. For all of you, it changed. We suddenly have a realization that America is not a nation that is all-powerful and isolated, that no one will ever harm us. I think the greatest eye-opening to that is, first of all, it was horrible. It was horrific. And then it was like we began to say, why are we hated so? Why, when we, as a nation, seem to do so much good, and we do, the money we give, the help we offer, the leadership we provide, why is it we are despised so that people would climb into planes and fly them into buildings and murder at such a scale. And this was a great, tremendous soul searching for America. And part of this is perhaps the fact that we have ignored much of the world in knowing what's going on. We need to no longer ignore the rest of the world. This often circumvents the editorial process. I mean, when I send in a script to CNN, of course, it has to go by the row. There's discussions. I find that process certainly very good. It's someone second guessing and second checking you, which is always vital. You know, did you really mean to say last, you know, in 1880? Oh, no, sorry, I meant to say 1980. You know, they catch obvious stuff like that, but then they also bring up issues. As a reporter, you can be so familiar with the story and you think you're explaining it well because you know every aspect of it. That it's a separate, fresh set of eyes that says, oh, you know, I don't get this part here. Well, what do you mean you don't get it? Well, it just blah, blah. And then it's like, oh, yeah, you're right, I left that out. Okay, you know. And so this is what is part of the problem with being able to instantly access the internet. Every one of you is, in essence, your own network. You can plug into the internet. You can report anything you want. And there is no one that is, one, checking your sources to see if you were even there, to do any of the basic journalistic firewall. This is an issue that comes up in a lot of ways. You know, I'm going to start spouting circumstances I can't speak of directly, but hopefully you have studied the instance or heard about. There was a woman in Georgia who worked for the Department of Agriculture who gave a speech to the NAACP. I wish I could remember her name, and I should have. Had I known I was going to be grilled. So she gives this speech. She talks about her experience of dealing with white farmers and black farmers. That was her role. And she implied to this primarily black audience that she did not serve and help a white farmer as much as she could have. This snippet from that speech got put on the internet by a conservative blogger and it went viral. I mean, it went everywhere. And she too fired. Just fired the Obama administration. Candor. Well, it turns out she was telling a story. It was part of an overall speech. And the story was that, yes, I did not treat that farmer as I should have. It was a story of redemption. She began to say, but you know what? I got to know the guy. They are best friends, they're very good friends today. It was an enlightening moment for her as a growing person, that the color of a person's skin doesn't matter. When they have a need, and when you are a representative of an organization that can help. It was a wonderful story. But when you lit that small section, it made her look terrible. And that apparently was the goal of the blogger, because they knew that it came from a whole speech, but they knew the whole story, but they only used that segment. Here again, normally in the journalistic process, and this is what I fault CNN for, because they began running the story without first going to the source, the person who made the speech. Did you really imply, did you really mean to say that you as a black representative for the Department of Agriculture purposely did not help a member, another farmer, because of the color of their skin? No, that wasn't what, you'd figure this out in about 2 seconds if you followed the rules that you are being taught here today in journalism. Instead, it went viral and the outrage, and the Obama administration fires her, CNN, Fox, everybody runs with it. A total breach here of the ethics that we are supposed to uphold, and frightening to see how quickly it can happen. That is a great concern for me now, is just that anybody can get on the internet and we believe it. That's the number one thing. Everybody believes it. Oh, it has to be true. It's not on the internet. Okay. Julian Assange, is that his name? This is the fellow WikiLeaks. An incredible circumstance. Man has no journalistic training, not a journalist at all. But what does he have? He's got a modem. And he's got a motive. His motive is he doesn't believe there should be any secrets in this world. Okay, you know, it's an interesting philosophical debate as we sit here in a classroom to have. But he takes all of the sensitive material that he gets from any number of people who give it to him for any number of reasons. Some could be criminals, some could be legitimate that they agree with his philosophy, some could be people who are just pissed off at the U.S. and happen to have a nasty secret that they would like to see exposed to the rest of the world. But the problem is some can be dangerous. There are reasons sometimes that certain knowledge is not revealed at a certain time because lives depend on it. Well, Julian Assange says, you know what, the overall good is better than those who may die as a result of what gets out there. Again, no journalistic training, no experience, But he is, in fact, a network and an informational source, and he's just pumping it out there. And that's the realities in which we're working today. If it had been the old days, Julian would have to have gone to what we would call the original media gatekeepers, a news organization, and they would say, well, first of all, who the hell are you? You know, what's your background? Why are you doing this? What motivates you? What's your, you know, why are you doing what you're doing? So there'd be all this sort of, again, check, check, double check, reaffirm. Would all the passages be put out there? No, of course not. We'd sit there and say, wait a minute here, some of this stuff is a little too sensitive. I think we're going to hold back on this. So that's the difference in the approach of a traditional journalistic method versus some of the stuff that's going out there today. There used to be a book that would sit in the library, and there may be one here, that listed every television station in the nation. You know. I think I knew that television is what I wanted to do. I'd figured out in college that print was not the way to go. I could never think of enough to say. You know. I was more of a broadcast kind of person and writer. So, okay, radio I liked, but radio, you didn't go anywhere. When you basically, for the most part, gathered for radio, you called somebody, and then you hit the record button. So I wanted to go play. I wanted to physically go. So that's why television was the career path for me. I knew that you had to go with a camera. You had to, you know, most times you had to really be there in order to be the reporter on scene. Okay. Then it was like, well, how do I get that job? So I went through this index that listed all the television stations, and I said, okay, well, I'm certainly not going to work in the top 50 markets, you know, just coming out of college. So 50 and below, I just started, you know, mailing resumes. Most of them didn't get anything, but one or two got an answer. And one of them was, you know, this local station in Champaign, Illinois. And they said, yeah, we'd like to have you come out. Now, I think today your opportunities are actually much brighter. But there's a double-edged sword to this. They're brighter in the sense that, of course, in the financial reality, most of you have the skill set that are ideal, or will have the skill set, I should say, for the modern broadcast journalist, and especially television. They want one-man bands. This is the person who can, you know, shoot their own stuff, who can do their own reporting, can edit their own material on Final Cut Pro or something like that, and can knock it out pretty doggone quick, and don't want to get a lot of money for doing it. They're just thrilled to be on TV, you know. So that makes you perfect fodder for this kind of environment in which many stations, who are being forced to cut their bottom lines. I mean, you know, it's not that they necessarily want to hire you at the cheapest. It's just that's the reality of their budgets. So I think that instead of saying, oh, I couldn't possibly break into the top 50 markets, I think you could. I don't think you can make the top 10, but you definitely could make the top 50, you know, somewhere in there, you know, 20 and below. The problem is you're going to get hired at such a low level, it's going to be very hard to get, you know, that kind of salary or that kind of dream that you want. And in a number of ways, these stations are going to say, well, you know, you really kind of owe us. You know, we gave you that break. We got you started, you know. So this idea of you want, you know, a $10,000 raise, I don't think so. You know, there's the door if you don't like it now, because there's another graduating class that's already come out, and you know. So be aware of those realities. Be careful in the places you work. Be careful of, you know, a lot of people want to work at the networks, and so you may get an opportunity, say, to work at a CNN, to work, enter their VJ program, or any number of entry levels. A lot of you will do internships at networks. You'll make communication, you know, you'll make contacts, and then you'll say, great, I'm going to go work at NBC right after this. And you will, you know, you can do that. It's going to be an entry-level job, and if you hope to be on the air, you are about as close to getting on the air in that job as you are if you're standing on the surface of Mars. It just ain't going to happen. Somebody isn't going to, you know, wander down the hallway, oh, how come I haven't seen you? Quick, get in front of the camera. You know, that's not going to happen. It looks good on the resume, and I would encourage you, okay, go work at NBC or CNN for a year or two. Gain as much as you can experience-wise, and then get out there and work in local TV, because that's where you're going to be doing what you want to do, if it's on camera, or actually doing the job. So the problem is you could stay too long at CNN working behind the scenes, hoping that somehow it's going to pay off. And the only way it's going to pay off is with the experience you gain that you take somewhere else, not with somebody discovering you having a cup of coffee down in the break room. I mean, that just isn't going to happen.